Tonight, all the gadgets fit to buy from CES. What's behind Amazon's Fire Phone flop? And an Apple Watch launch might actually be near. Tech News Tonight is next.
This is Twit.
This is Tech News Tonight, episode 247 for Tuesday, January 6th, 2015. This episode is brought to you by Lynda.com. Invest in yourself for 2015 with Lynda.com, which has thousands of courses to help you learn new tech, new business, and new creative skills. For a free 10-day trial, visit Lynda.com/TN2. That's LYNDA.com/TN and the number 2. Hello, everyone. I'm Sarah Lane, and we are going to go straight to Las Vegas, Nevada, now that the river of gadget news from CES is officially raging. And joining us is Twit's very own Father Robert Ballecer, who's been hanging out on the show floor, oh gosh, since over the weekend. So let's talk to him now. Hey, Father Robert.
Hey, Sarah. Good to see you.
Good to see you too. All right. So I'm just gonna come out and ask, what is officially the coolest thing that you've seen yet? I know you have done your best to absorb as much as you can on in the very, very large trade show, as you do every year. You're a CES veteran.
Yes, that's my thing. I love this time of year because we get to see concepts that won't actually make it to market. And I think that's actually the coolest thing. The coolest thing I've seen have been the self-driving cars that we've seen from Audi, from BMW, and even Mercedes. They've taken the idea that Google had with self-driving cars. They've combined it with some of the technologies that Tesla really pioneered, and they've come out with their own version of what the future of automobiles might look like.
And what is that future?
It looks like Tron, basically. If you took a look at Mercedes' new car,
it looks really different than the Mercedes that I drive. It's like a big egg with lots of lights, but I want it.
Made out of plastic, but it looks really, really cool. But the one that's actually closer to reality, I think, is the Audi. Audi took a look at a new technology that they debuted on stage. The CEO actually used his watch, his LG Android watch, to summon the car. And the car came to him on stage, that's actually kind of nice. I mean, when you think about what you could do with that, you could pull up to a restaurant, get out, hit a button on your watch, and your car would find its own parking. That's actually something that people would buy. I mean, let's forget the self-driving thing for a while because that's going to take a while. But a self-parking car or a car that will come back to you, it's your own personal valet.
Now, CES actually has a really big car component. That's when I've been at the show in the past. It's one of my favorite places to hang out because everything just looks so cool. But a lot of this is still somewhat conceptual, right?
Yeah, and I don't see that as a negative. One of the things that I used to love about the old CES before, let's be honest, before the smartphone and the tablet craze, was you would see products that 90% sure you would not actually see in production. I like seeing those concepts. And I think that's what we're starting to see with the cars again. That's why that has me excited. I want to see what engineers have on their mind, even if the product doesn't make it to the showroom floor. I think we're seeing that this year.
Let's move on to TVs, always a big favorite at CES. We have seen a few different Android TV sets that have been announced by Philips, by Sharp, and by Sony that are coming this spring. I mean, this is the nuts and bolts of what's inside TVs. How much do you think this is meaning Google TV is over and Android TV is the future?
Right. I think we should step back a little bit because what Google did with the Chromecast is a little bit like what they did with the Nexus series of devices. They just wanted to put it into the mind of the manufacturers what you could do with their technology. They didn't necessarily say you have to integrate it. Now, we know that Google made that bold claim that a few CESs back that they would be in X percentage of TVs by the end of the year. And that didn't happen. But what we are starting to see is that people are taking technology, some from Google, some from others, integrating it into their smart TVs. And that's now the starting cost. If you want to be in this industry, if you want to sell TVs, especially if you want to sell connected TVs that are going to do 4K or 5K, you have to have some smarts on the inside. I don't think that means Google TV is dead. I don't mean that the Chromecast is gone. But I think it now means the manufacturers will take what they have and run with it. I want to see that. I want to see what they'll do to put their mark on Google TV.
Well, and Google has obviously learned a lot about the future of television the last few years. We've got Google TV. The Chromecast has been extremely successful. The company has said Android TV and Chromecast are not, they can live together in harmony. They're two different products. Also, you've got big brands like LG, Panasonic, Samsung, all not being on board with Android TV just yet.
Absolutely. And I think this is actually one of the other trends that we're seeing at CES. Everyone knew it was going to happen. It's the Internet of Things. It's the connected house. It's the automated whatever. Many of those manufacturers, especially Samsung with their purchase of SmartThings, are looking at this trend, this Internet of Things and Google TV / Smart TV. And they're saying, wait a minute. What if we own the operating system? What if we own the back end that goes into our smart TV and it becomes the gateway to controlling everything from your refrigerator to your washer and dryer to your security to your cameras to your internet? They're not on board because, well, they've got other options. Many of the other manufacturers don't really want to develop their own OS. They don't want to develop a lot of the hooks that would be necessary to make this happen. So they're going to rely on companies like SmartThings. Samsung's, on the other hand, saying, we own SmartThings, so why don't we put out a bigger footprint? Why don't we make Samsung Internet of Things synonymous with Internet of Things? I think that's the strategy that they're trying to take.
Yeah, you mentioned SmartThings. Samsung has unveiled the SmartThings Hub at CES, which is kind of a next-generation smart home hub and monitoring service. They haven't given us a price yet, but we know that there's all sorts of things you can do, including being able to automatically call or text somebody that you've added as a contact if there's a case of emergency or attempted break-in. It's pretty cool. Also, famously, Apple is not has no official presence at CES, but HomeKit, which has not even launched, accessories have started to show up. I know iHome's smart plug, which is about $40, would let you, let's say, turn on and off a lamp via something that you plug into your to your power source via your smartphone. I like the idea of that just because I would like to do that. And $40 sounds kind of reasonable.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, one of the things that Apple is known for is they don't have to jump into the fray at the beginning. That's not their thing. They want to see where the dust is going to settle. And they're going to come in and they're going to give us a beautiful interface and a very easy to use product. And people are just going to like it from the outset. So they're waiting. This is a battle. This whole Internet of Things, this home automation market, it's just really heating up. We've had it for a while, but finally, the big competitors are throwing their rings into the hat. So Apple's going to say, wait a minute, we want to see what Samsung's going to do. We want to see what LG is going to do. We want to see how this Google integration is going to work, and then we can give you something better. And that's always been their MO. And this is a very low risk, low impact way for them to see whether or not an Apple-centric Internet of Things is going to work.
You know, it's also kind of, and maybe it's just because I move around a lot and I'm a renter, I wonder how much so many of these smart homes will work and be relevant to people who are not homeowners and don't necessarily, you know, want to invest the time and effort and organization into something that seems very temporary.
Well, and that's the genius of both Samsung and Apple's approach. They don't want you to have to reinstall your smart home as you move from apartment to apartment. They envision a future where everything is smart and everything mm-hmm. speaks the same language, preferably their language, which means that when you're a renter in San Francisco and you move into a new apartment, your device will automatically speak to the washer and the dryer and the doorbell and the locks there. You won't have to install anything. They want a future where everything is ready to go. You just move with your profile. So, I mean, Sarah, how would you love it if you moved into a new apartment and automatically your new apartment knew all the things you liked? It knew when you wanted to open your windows and when you wanted to restock your fridge and when you wanted to turn the temperature up and down. That's what they want. They're not selling you
Sounds great.
Hardware. They're
like
selling
having a friend that I live inside.
That's what
came to mind.
but you know what, Sarah, that's actually not the only thing that we saw at CES. There is one other thing that I specifically thought of you when we filmed this. 3D printers have been around for a while. We've known that. They're coming down in price. This year, we've started to see, and we actually have B-roll for this, Anthony, we've started to see that the quality is going way up and the price is going way down. We took a look in the Sands Innovation Pavilion. This is a company called XYZ Printing. This is a little $349 printer that actually works really, really well. But it's not just that. XYZ realizes that they had to surround this printer with other things that you might use. So there's this. They've got a robotic hydroponics lab. It's not named yet. I'm calling it the MJ420. But this ties in to the 3D printer and your home automation system so that you can make this part of your smart environment. But wow. This is the thing I really like. Sarah, this is a 3D food printer. Now, this thing can use chocolate or dough cartridges, and basically it will build up these intricate patterns of desserts and sweets. It was kind of silly, but it was all to promote the release of some of their new scanning technologies. And I think the scanning technologies is what's going to make 3D printing next generation, because it's no longer buy a 3D printer and then not know how to program it. It's scan something that you like, improve it a little bit, and reprint it. I mean, how many times have you seen a product that you said, you know, it would be just a little bit better if there was a little handle on this edge, or if there was a mounting hole on this side? Well, now you could do that. Scan it, change it, print it, you're done.
Father Robert Ballecer is obviously a host of many shows here on the network. This Week in Enterprise Tech, of course, Coding 101, Know How, Padres Corner is your newest show. Is there anything you can't do except obviously cover CES as well?
I can't bake, which is why I like the 3D printing food thing.
And it's pretty. Yeah. You don't even, got to go to baking school, whatever it is that they do. Thanks so much for joining us. And I hope that you have enough Band-Aids for the blisters that you will inevitably have by the end of the week.
Thanks, Sarah.
All right. Coming up on the show, inside the rather tumultuous lab that built Amazon's Fire Phone and the thinnest MacBook Air might be right around the corner. But first, we want to thank Lynda.com for sponsoring this episode of Tech News Tonight. Lynda.com is used by millions of people all over the world and has over 4,500 courses on all sorts of topics: web development, photography, business, virtual design. You might need some software training like WordPress. Maybe you're finally ready to master Excel or Photoshop. What is your plan for this year? You probably would love to sharpen some business skills. Maybe you want a raise and you have to prove that you deserve it. Maybe you just need to be more marketable for a new job. Hey, it's a new year. It's a new you. We recommend Lynda.com courses like, as I mentioned, Excel tips and tricks, or managing your manager. Everybody's got a manager. And the weekly Office Workshop series gives you a new Microsoft Office tip every single Tuesday. Hey, you might have just a few minutes, or you might have all week, but each course is structured so you can learn at your own pace from start to finish. And of course, all Lynda.com courses are taught by experts. They're professionals. They know what they're talking about. They're at the top of their field, and they're teaching you. So do something good for yourself in 2015 and sign up for a free 10-day trial to Lynda.com just by doing this. Go to Lynda.com/TN2. That's Lynda.com/TN2. And you get unlimited access to every course on Lynda.com. That includes access on your iOS or your Android device and new courses as they're added each week. Lynda.com/TN2 and try it free for 10 days. Go ahead. We challenge you to learn something new in 2015. All right, let's move on to some Amazon news right now, specifically Amazon's Fire Phone, which has not exactly set the smartphone world on fire. And joining us to talk more about this is Nathaniel Mott, reporter at Pando Daily. Hi, Nathaniel.
Hi, Sarah. How's it going?
Well, really good. Thanks for being here. I know it's on the East Coast where you are, and so you're probably very tired after covering technology all day. So we got a feature in Fast Company magazine that is profiling Jeff Bezos, obviously CEO of Amazon, and how his vision of Amazon's Fire Phone may not really have been in line with what the general public wants in a phone, and is there a disconnect there? The article also cites managerial changes and departures from Lab 126, which is Amazon's R&D lab, which is somewhat secretive, but we know a bit about how it's grown over the last few years. So what is your take on why the Fire Phone kind of failed? I know that you've been covering this since it was released.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty much what Fast Company said, was that Jeff Bezos had an idea of what he wanted in a smartphone, and he tasked his team with creating that and ignored basically anything related to costs or what consumers might want or what Amazon's even done in the past. So it seems like he was trying to assert a little more control over something that he maybe didn't know as much about. Mm-hmm. And that just doesn't work out for companies often.
How does that happen? Lab 126 is there's It started off pretty small. I think about had about 100 employees 5 years ago, very stealth mode. It now has around 3,000 employees. Its headquarters are in Silicon Valley, not in Washington State. And Reuters reported recently that Amazon was planning to invest many millions more into the lab. $55 million was the last quote. Ramp up hiring to over 3,000 employees. But we're also hearing about a lot of people in executive positions either leaving the lab or kind of getting shuffled around. What do you think that spells for the future of Amazon's consumer electronics?
I mean, I hope that it's going to put people in place who are willing to tell Bezos when he's wrong. Because it seems to me like there were not necessarily enablers, but people who capitulated to him, and which is understandable. I mean, he's Jeff Bezos, you know, he's obviously in charge. But I think there needed to be someone who somewhere along the line said, look, we're releasing something that's not going to help consumers, it's not going to help us, and it's not going to help Amazon's brand. Mm-hmm. So hopefully they're going to shuffle enough people to make that happen. They're going to hire new people, and maybe Bezos will stay in Seattle. I don't know.
Amazon obviously really controls online retail. You know, the company is talking about drone delivery. I mean, they really have some lofty goals, especially if you look 5-10 years into the future. Does the company have any business being in the smartphone business, though?
It depends on who you ask. I think if you ask Amazon, the answer is yes, because that way they control every aspect of how someone purchases things from their platform. I mean, one of the things that people liked about the Fire Phone is that you can easily scan barcodes and buy things on Amazon. You know, it's got Amazon Digital Services pre-installed, and Amazon doesn't have to deal with a 30% cut that Apple takes when things are purchased through iOS. So from a business standpoint, Amazon absolutely needs to be in the smartphone business. But from the consumer's perspective, I don't think anybody, especially now, is thinking like, oh man, I really need that Amazon phone in my life. Mm-hmm. You know, they're still thinking like, look, I want an iPhone, or I want one of the many Android devices available.
Amazon certainly has the money to put into research and development. Its lab is not the only lab that There are similar labs. Microsoft has one, for example. Of course, the name is escaping me right now. Of course, Google has its own internal project where there's a lot of hardware that's at least being worked on. Some of it is seeing the light of day. Some of it we don't know about yet. Is this kind of par for the course for Amazon? Is a failure of a smartphone not the end of the world? Or does it tell us something about perhaps how the CEO of the company may have too much control?
I think it indicates that. I don't think it's going to like portend doom for Amazon or something, but I think that it made a good phone, or it took a good opportunity and squandered it. You know, it was entering the smartphone race. People really cared about this. I mean, there were leaks for years and years that Amazon was working on this, and every time people got so excited. And then Amazon released an overpriced phone that they ultimately lost like millions of dollars on. And it just didn't work out for them. So I think that the development of a product like this might have been par for the course, but the release of a product like this is not.
What are your predictions for the future of Amazon's lab 126? It's again, we've got some executive shifts. We've got some people leaving the company, but Amazon has said, and certainly Reuters has reported, that they are invested. They are invested in consumer technology, hardware, and it's not going away.
I think they're going to keep experimenting. I mean, they have stuff like the speaker that's constantly listening to you. They're building out their drone deliveries. They have that little dongle thing that you can use to like remind yourself what groceries you want to buy or something. Right. So I think it really shows that Amazon is going to be doing more with hardware, and Lab 126 is obviously going to be a big part of that. But I think that it's going to be more wacky, experimental Amazon stuff instead of like, well, I guess we have to release a smartphone now.
They have to try to figure out what they're good at and stick with that. Kindle has been very good for them, for example. Nathaniel Mott reports over at Pando Daily and joins us live from New York. Thanks so much for joining us, Nathaniel. And before we let you go, remind people where they can keep up with all of your work.
Yeah, just follow me on Twitter and head over to Pando every day.
That's Nathaniel Mott on Twitter. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Okay, on to a couple more stories that we're following today. Not CES related, but 9 to 5 Mac is reporting that Apple is preparing a new MacBook Air with a much thinner and a much lighter body with a higher resolution display, and is even doing away with components like full-sized USB ports, MagSafe connectors, and SD card slots in order to keep the profile nice and sleek. Sources within Apple who claim to have used the internal prototype versions of the upcoming computer tell 9 to 5 Mac that the new 12-inch MacBook Air, yes, 12-inch, would be smaller than the current 13-inch version and also a quarter of an inch narrower and taller than the 11-inch model. So kind of different dimensions altogether, with reduced bezels on all sides to obviously make the screen bigger. A new trackpad design could even forego the clicking effect of current MacBook trackpads. That would be very different. It would almost be almost iOS-like, in fact, and it would sit underneath a wider keyboard. Of course, these are rumors, and they've also put the new MacBook Air shipping sometime in mid-2015, but that's exactly how to treat this one for now, as a rumor. We're just looking at mock-ups for all you people who are watching the video version of the show. But if you like rumors, I have another one. 9 to 5 Mac also reports today that Apple's Apple Watch software is nearing completion, according to sources familiar with the product's development, and the product may ship, at least in the United States, by the end of March. Now, the company has said that the watch will ship in early 2015. That's what we got when it was announced. And Senior Vice President of Retail, Angela Arendts, previously told employees internally that the launch would occur sometime in the spring after the Chinese New Year. Apple has set pricing for the Apple Watch Sport model at $349, but hasn't yet announced pricing for its stainless steel and sapphire crystal standard model or its gold version, which is rumored to be in the thousands of dollars. Finally, yesterday we told you about SpaceX's attempt to launch a Falcon 9 rocket carrying cargo to the International Space Station by first bringing the first stage of the rocket down onto a floating platform in the Atlantic Ocean. Sadly, a last-minute problem with an actuator postponed the launch. So if you're feeling a little bit blue about that, perhaps you'd like to try the space-building simulation game Kerbal Space Program. If you haven't heard of it, users create spaceships, virtual spaceships, that can reach orbit and they can land on the moon or they can even travel further into space. The game is reportedly really accurate in terms of actual rocket physics and engineering, and spaceships don't always fly successfully, so it's kind of hard. The next generation of flight sim, you could think, to infinity and beyond. Kerbal Space Program is currently in beta and is available on Windows, for Mac, and even Linux for $30. And that is it for this edition of Tech News Tonight. You can subscribe to the show at twit.tv/TN2. You can write us with feedback, and we hope you do, at TN2 at twit.tv. And of course, you can watch live every weekday at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern Time. We have a morning news program as well, Tech News Today. Do you watch it? You should. Tomorrow and every weekday at 10 a.m. Pacific, 1 p.m. Eastern. I'm Sarah Lane. Thanks for watching.
Bandwidth for Tech News Tonight is brought to you by CashFly.com.